Hey, it's time for TV Skywriter.
Good evening, everybody. Welcome to TV Skywriter. I'm Pat Murray, your host. This show emanates from Durham, North Carolina. I like to talk to writers and musicians, entrepreneurs, and just people with really interesting things to say. Now, today I've got two guests. Yes, two. I have Darlene Gidney. She is a producer and director, and her company is called Be Rich Entertainment, LLC. Welcome to the show.
Thank you.
Absolutely. We also have Joan Jay. She's an actor and an educator. Welcome to the show.
Thank you, Pat. Glad to be here.
Very happy to have both of you. Now, I want to start out thanking Aduke Aremu for setting this up, because she wanted to make sure that we all were able to tell people about not only the National Black Theater Festival. That's isn't that what, every 2 years, is it?
Every 2 years.
Every odd year, yes.
Okay, in Winston-Salem, North Carolina, a couple of cities over. And then in particular, what we're going to talk about is the Frank Silvera Writers Workshop. And both of you know about that, right?
Oh, most definitely.
So who wants to tell us what that is? How it started?
You want to start, Joan?
With the Frank Silvera Writers Workshop?
Yes, go ahead.
The Frank Silvera Writers Workshop is a workshop where actors, directors, producers, and mainly playwrights come together to expose new works. And the playwrights usually submit the play to the workshop, and a director is chosen, and then it is cast, and they read it for an audience. And the audience gives them a critique. It allows the playwright to hear his words come alive and to rewrite where he needs to, not specifically based, but partly based on the critique that he receives from the audience, as well as what he hears when his words become alive from the actors. That's basically what Frank Silvera Writers Workshop is about. Wouldn't you say so, Darlene?
Yes, Frank Silvera Writers Workshop is developmental theater. It is the point in the process where writers may have an idea, and they take that idea and they put it on the page, and eventually through development, it is read on the stage, and even a fully mounted productions been born out of the workshop.
Now, I'm just an average citizen. I don't know what goes on behind the scenes much when it comes to theater, TV, or movies. So I have to ask, so what we see in the movies and on TV, they have all, and also plays, of course, and musicals, does everything that ends up, you know, being produced for us, the audience, go through the same process where after the words are written down, they're read out loud and tweaked in this manner?
Well, they should be. Not saying, I don't know whether or not they actually do, but they should be. The Frank Silvera Writers Workshop, which was founded by the late Clayton Riley, Garland Lee Thompson, Billy Allen, and Morgan Freeman. It was designed for playwrights of color to have an opportunity to express their voice, because back in the late 60s, early 70s, the date's wrong, Joan, please correct me.
It began in 73.
They did not have an opportunity to express themselves. So to answer your question, whether or not that process is done by all movies, because movies is a screenplay, that's completely different than a regular theater play, and television developmental script is different. So whether they actually go through the process, I don't know. They should, but not necessarily.
Oh, okay.
Well, as an actor, I can add that when we do a play on stage, mm-hmm. prior, the first thing we do once we're cast and we all come together with the director, the producer, the playwright maybe, and all the actors, the first the lighting and technicians, and the mm-hmm. first thing we do is read the play.
Yes.
We read the play. But that is for our understanding of what to start to connect to the piece more. But when it's read at the workshop, at the writer's workshop, that is primarily for the playwright to develop the play further. You see, because as Darlene was saying, there are a couple of components. Whereas one day, or perhaps on a Saturday, there's a meeting where the playwright brings what he has developed. It might be 10 pages. It might be 3 pages. Mm-hmm. You know, and actors volunteer, for the most part, to read his play or her play. And then once the play is blossomed out to a full-fledged play, then again it is brought to the workshop, and this is when it is actually read as a play for an audience. Mm-hmm. The first reading, when they bring the first 5 or 10 pages, is specifically for writers and for actors. It's not for an audience, for a critique.
So how is it that the actors are able to read the parts in a way that give the director some guidance? Because I'm guessing if they're his or her words, he already knows how it would sound, right?
No, it's actually during the process of development, the writers are taught how to create a theater script. So the 5 pages, for example, or 10, let's say 5, let's go with 5 pages. 5 pages come in the form of a script, and they have to be formatted in a script. So that's how the actors understand the synopsis, the character profile, and the words that they have to read. It is a win-win for the actor and the writer, because it also allows actors to horn in on their craft of being an actor, of having a co-reading, of being able to bring the characters alive just by being given the script and to start reading. And it is a lot of fun. I can just attest to the fact that it is a lot of fun to see these pieces in there, from a thought to a couple of pages to 10 pages, 20 pages, and the next thing you know, Johnny is having his reading tonight, and we all want to come because we want to hear the whole play. Because a good writer is not going to give you the whole story. You're going to have to come to the reading to hear the whole entire story put together.
What's it like going to a reading? Because I think most of us have seen, well, I would guess all of us have seen TV and movies. I don't know if all of us have been to the theater to see plays. But what's it like to go to a reading?
What's it like to go to a reading? Well, you have lay people who just want to hear, and you have people who are literary people, usually some degree of intelligence. But you usually have to know something about playwriting. Usually these are the ones that critique. A literary crowd you have quite often, but you also have the people who just want to come and enjoy it and be a part of it, you know. And the main thing is that the critique is not given to the playwright to rewrite the playwright's play. You have to give a critique that gels with the understanding that you are helping to develop the play and not rewrite the playwright's play. Mm-hmm. So those things are taken into consideration in a writer's workshop that is dealing with plays.
Mm-hmm. Yes. Can I just add on to what Joan was saying? Because the Frank Silvera Writers Workshop and we're talking about the process of writing and critiquing, and is none like any other, because as Garland used to say, it's not a feel good workshop. You know, sometimes I've seen writers actually their feelings were hurt and they never came back, but those writers that were able to stick out and to listen to their colleagues, because those are the people who are really critiquing their work most of the time, especially when we used to have, because we had two sessions. We had a Saturday session and a Monday session. Right. And the Saturday session, you were amongst your peers. And your peers would listen to what you wrote, because that's what a reading is about, listening. Mm-hmm. And you would listen to what they wrote. And then it was like, does this make sense? How are you going to go from across the street to the next day, and there's no process for you to get there? And that's the wonderful part about a reading, about this particular workshop, and how those who were able to go through the process have very solid work and very successful productions, because of the fact that your colleagues, they love it. They love coming, and they love helping each other to get their work, you're as if you were the writer, tightened up and able to be ready to produce and mount it.
Okay. So what is the relationship of the Frank Silvera Writers Workshop to the National Black Theater Festival? This is going to be held the first week in August.
Well, since Larry Leon Hamlin, the late Larry Leon Hamlin, began the festival in 1989, mm-hmm. Garland Lee Thompson Sr. was almost like a co-founder of it, in that he brought the reading theater series to it at the request of Larry Leon Hamlin. Yes. So it's been a very prominent, necessary part of the National Black Theater Festival since its inception in 1989.
Okay. So people who are watching this are probably wondering what the National Black Theater Festival is. Could you tell us?
Well, I mean, I can just tell you about Garland's relationship and what he did in the festival, which was very interesting, because they do have fully mounted productions. They present that, and then Garland brought the reader series too. So while the fully mounted productions are going on from 12 o'clock noon to 12 midnight is the last reading, from Tuesday till 12 o'clock noon Saturday, there are readings of new works by playwrights from all over the country, all over the world, really, but, you know, all over the country and the world. And it is a very exciting time. I know that there has been times where there have been at least 40 new plays that have been read during the course of the festival. And those of us who are avid we attend readings and we attend developmental theater, this is a very exciting time for us.
So have the both of you actually been there when you've seen a play, observed a play being written, and then maybe, I don't know how long it takes to make a fully produced play, but have you almost like forgotten about a play, like you enjoyed it during the festival, and then maybe a year or so later, you're like, oh, and you recognize it when you see it on the stage?
Well, the National Black Theater Festival was created by Larry Lee Hamlin, mm-hmm. to bring black theater, okay, black, and they say black theater is for everyone, mm-hmm. to bring black theater to a place where everybody could come and enjoy it. And it's international. These are companies, theater companies from all over the world, and you're able to see all kinds of wonderful, wonderful theater productions. And they have a tremendous amount of celebrities that come as well, a tremendous amount. Mm-hmm. And the Reader's Theater part, the celebrities take part in that too. They're guest readers, but the playwrights that present their plays in the Reader's Theater Series at the National Black Theater, those are fully developed plays.
Mm-hmm. Oh, they're already fully developed.
Yes, oh yes. Oh,
okay.
Oh yes, but can I just piggyback on what Joan was saying? What happens, Pat, is that there's a saying that we have, you either come as a spectator or you come as a participant. And a lot of people, who attend the festival actually come as participants, meaning that they come strictly just to participate in the readings that are going to go on from Tuesday till Saturday. They come ready to read in a play. They come with their headshots. They come ready. They come ready for people to select them to read. Now, the playwrights, they come ready to produce their work, and they have to wait, and they're given a time to that they're going to read. Once they're given that time to read, they literally have to go all around the festival, getting actors to read their play, they practice, they rehearse, they make little flyers, they pass them out, and it's a very exciting time during the life of the festival.
That sounds really exciting. I had the wrong impression. I was thinking that you would have the play read at the festival and then go to your original, you know, your town that you live in and then finish the play. That's what I was thinking.
But there are plays, like the first play that was read, which was The Old Settler. Mm-hmm. I don't know if you've ever heard of that play. Was one of the first plays that was read at the National Black Theater Festival at the first festival. That play made national acclaim because it went on to be produced as a play. It also was produced as a movie with
Alicia Rashad
and Debbie Allen.
Mm-hmm. I starred in it as Elizabeth Borney over, since this is here in the Triangle area, I starred in that play by John Henry Redwood.
Yes.
At the Raleigh Little Theater. I believe it was, it was around 2007, I think. I might be wrong. But at any rate, I won Best Actress in a Lead Role for that, for that play.
Yeah.
Wonderful play.
Yes, wonderful.
Yes, absolutely wonderful. But it was first started, as Darlene says, first read at the Frank Silvera Writers Workshop and read at the festival.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. I'm curious how the plays are even chosen, because if you're having... it sounds like an awful lot of plays are being read there during the festival. So how do they get the attention of the people who run the festival, and how are the plays chosen?
Well, that was Garland's position. Garland, all of the plays would have been submitted to the festival, and then one copy would have been submitted to the festival for archival purposes, and then the other copy was mailed to Garland in New York for selection process. And I personally work with Garland during festival time to log every single play that came into his office. Mm-hmm. And once he did that, he read them, he would select them, and you would either get a little postcard in the mail saying you were either selected for the A list or the B list. Very exciting. Let me tell you something. As a playwright, that's a very, very exciting time to receive a little card in the mail saying that you were that your play was selected for an A-list to be read at the National Black Theater Festival.
Wow.
You had tell to confirm the difference whether between or not the A-list and the B-list, Darlene.
Say that again.
Tell the difference between the A-list and the B-list.
Well, the A-list meant that you were going to read either at high noon. Or at midnight.
Mm-hmm.
I was fortunate that I was able to direct 2 years in a row a play that my partner at that time had written, and we read at midnight. We read at midnight on the first night we came, and the second year that we came to the festival. So we had both of our plays read 2 years in a row at the midnight series. So if you were selected, and when you are selected, you better get to Winston-Salem so that you can sign in and say that you're here so that you can have your play read.
Wow. And again, it's going to be during the first week of August.
Yes. It will be from August the 4th to August the 8th.
Okay. August 4th to 8th.
Well, actually, the 3rd is when they have the gala.
Yes.
That night is the gala.
Thank you, great opening
where they have, and we don't know what the opening play is going to be this year because they won't announce that until next week.
Until tomorrow, right? Isn't it tomorrow?
Yeah, tomorrow.
Mm-hmm.
That's true. I'm thinking next week.
Yes. But that's okay, you know. Listen, it's a lot to remember.
Yeah, it is.
A lot to remember.
I want to ask the two of you, okay, I've known people who wrote plays and, you know, wrote poetry and wrote screenplays and all this sort of thing, and I'd like to ask the two of you, what makes for a good script? Because I think a lot of people can write scripts. But I wonder what makes for a good script that you can actually picture being produced when you read it.
Okay, Darlene, you come from the director, I'll come from the actor, okay?
You say what you want to say. I'm going to say a couple of things, but go ahead.
Okay.
You want me to go first or you, Joan?
Mm-hmm.
Huh?
Come on.
Okay. What makes a good script? I'm gonna talk from a producer's perspective.
Okay.
From a producer's perspective, what makes a good script is something that has a great storyline, excellent character development, it has a setup, and a payoff. That makes it for a good script. Does it make sense? Is it, it's not extremely expensive to produce.
Mm-hmm.
And also, can your audience leave with something? Can your audience leave with something? Is it, whether or not it's crying, laughing, it's sorrow, you have to. Your audience has to leave with something.
Hmm.
And the most important thing is that they're going to tell someone else, you got to come back and see that play.
Oh.
That's what, to me, that's what makes a good script. Does it make sense? Does it, what can I learn from this script? What am I learning? What is it bringing to me? Why would I want to sit here for an hour and a half? Is it too long? Is it too short? There's so many components to an excellent script.
Okay.
Can you tell
the length when you read the script? Can you
say that again?
Can you get a sense of how long? I guess it's hard to picture how long a script would be to produce because.
No, you can. You can. I mean, a good script is like around 66 pages, 65,
yeah.
66, 67 pages. Anything okay. over that is going to be a book, I think.
And Pat.
66 pages, Pat.
If I can jump in here and say that, piggybacking on Darlene, for this particular, the audience message definitely is absolutely necessary, okay? But the actor, well, we have to have actors, okay? For one thing, you don't want anything that's too wordy, you know, and you need action. You know what I'm saying? Just a bunch of words does not get it. You want authenticity. You know, you need emotion, you need action, you know, and you need people to be doing things. People just don't want to just look at a stage and all they hear is words. That's terribly boring, you know.
Yeah.
And the words have to flow. The words have to be believable to the actor. You are investing yourself in it. You know what I'm saying? And so if you're saying something that you don't believe or doesn't make sense, then it just doesn't work. You take someone like August Wilson, but there's August Wilson's words just flow. He just makes it. There's another playwright. Oh God, I can't think of who it is right now. Who, anytime she writes a play, I think it's a female. I can't think of her right now. She writes a play. You know it's going to be good. You know it's. Oh, you know who I'm thinking about? The one who writes Scandal. The one who writes Scandal and Grey's Anatomy. You know what I'm talking about.
Yes, I can't remember her name, but yes. Because there's conversation there. There's
right.
a conversation that's really very important, and the conversation makes sense.
Right. You know, you have monologues, you're talking to each other. You it's not long diatribes of rhetoric.
Yeah.
So it's getting to the point and leaving the audience with, people want to feel, people want to go places, you know, and we must remember that it's all about entertainment, but
yes.
it's also about enlightenment.
Yes.
You know, when you go to a play, you might not remember every word. You're sitting there in the audience and you're watching the play, but the people on stage are working, you know, they're in it, you know, but you're watching it, you know, and when you're watching it, all of a sudden, You might go someplace where you were 10 years old and forget everything that's happening on that stage. But when you leave that theater, you know, when you leave that theater, you are impressed. You are impressed, and you take it home with you because it gives you a feeling, so you connect. And that's one of the things that you want in theater. That's one of the things that playwrights want to do. They want, just like any other artist, you want to connect with the people.
Yeah.
And you can, when you read a script, you must have a certain, I can't imagine not everybody would have the opportunity, or not the opportunity, the ability to look at a script and tell if it connects with an audience. Unless
well,
you
can I just say this, Pat? And I'm going to say it. Every script that is written, unfortunately, is not a good script and may need work. So that's what the workshop came in. This is for developmental writing. So just because you wrote a script and it came through the workshop and it was written doesn't mean that it was there yet. So sometimes you may have heard, well, still needs a little work.
And then I mean, you pick up scripts that are books. You know where I'm talking about action. You got to have action in your words. People want to see the word come alive. When you're sitting and you're just, it's just a book. Sometimes you get a script. Am I right, Darlene? And it's a book.
Yeah, it needs work, and it's not ready. But it's just not ready. That's how you know, Pat. Some things are just not ready.
I'm trying to tell you.
Yes.
Okay, now, you have to leave something to the audience's imagination. You can't tell them everything. You take them to the water, but you don't drink it for them.
Okay. Now, what about those 1940s style scripts, those movies that are from stage plays that are what, I think my sister used the word stage bound, but somehow they work. Do those types of plays and scripts work for today's audience?
Ask that question again, because I'm not understanding what you're wanting.
There are some 1940s plays that became movies that are what you would call stage bound. You're talking about action. Okay.
So what happens? What would have happened, Pat? You have a screenplay. That's one script. Then you would have another script, which is your theater script. So the script would have been edited for the theater, because there are things that you can do on the theater, on the stage, that you can do on the screen, and there's things that you can do on the screen that you can't do on the stage. So then there would be two completely different scripts.
Okay.
And let me just throw in that playwright, the playwright that I was talking about, that Shonda Rhimes. You know, I just want to make sure that we give her credit, but we have after Shonda Rhimes. When she writes, the actor can stand still and deliver a monologue because you have a myriad of emotions in that monologue, and that's really what you want, you know.
Okay. Right. But those are scripts that are made for TV. Mm-hmm. And made for movies. So it's a little different than a live performance, wouldn't you say, Joan?
Yeah, but what I'm talking about is her writing as far as monologues and things like that.
Yes, I'm in agreement.
A good monologue, she would be right with August Wilson. I think of Fences and I think of Rose, you know, the monologue that she gives, you know what I'm saying? And the one that Cicely Tyson gave when she was on How to Get Away with Murder, most recently, Shonda Rhimes. So those monologues are absolutely wonderful, but you can stand still and give those, you know what I'm saying, because the words carry you, but you can't do that throughout the play. You can't stand still throughout the play.
Mm-hmm. You know, there was a really strange movie that I watched some years ago. I think it was called The Slender Thread. I don't know if you're familiar with that at all. Sidney Poitier was the star. And I can't remember the female lead. I can't remember her name. But basically, he did the entire movie while on the phone. Basically, the female star had just overdosed. And she had called, he was a young college student who was volunteering on the suicide helpline.
Mm-hmm.
The lady had just overdosed, or just was causing an overdose, and was, the whole movie was her talking to him about her life. And of course, like you were saying, they were doing things, this probably was a play, I'm sure it was a play.
Oh yes, it's a play.
Mm-hmm. But her part was shown in flashback.
Mm-hmm.
But Sidney Poitier, his entire, just about his entire presence on the screen was him on the phone.
Mm-hmm.
And the emotions he went through while being like this throughout the whole movie was astonishing.
Mm-hmm.
It was absolutely astonishing. I can imagine whoever read that script probably had the hairs on the back of their neck standing up, because that was an amazingly written play and an amazing movie. Do you ever come across scripts like that that you're like, whoa?
Well, you have to have a beginning, a middle, and an end. Mm-hmm. And in a play, it's called the climax. Yes. You know what I'm saying? You build to a point, and then you come down. You know, the beginning, the middle, and the end. And you are there. You are there. The intensity is there. Mm-hmm. The intensity is there. You are right there with the person who's getting ready to commit suicide. So you're sitting on the edge of your seat listening. You're right there.
Right.
But can I just say this to you, though, Pat? It's very important that the playwright's words, the actor, and the director all gel together to make it exciting, to make you think, to make you feel. And every segment of a production, and I'm going to say production because first it's your producer, then it's your director, then ultimately everything is handed over to the it's the producer, it's the writer with the script, then it's the director, then it's the actor. Mm-hmm. And once it's handed over to the actor, it's really up to the actor to bring these characters to life, to give these characters to put breath inside the characters so that the characters are believable. And there are times, I'm quite sure, Joan, where you have seen or you've been a part of where they may call you the character's name because you have given so much life to that particular character.
That's right.
And see, and what's interesting is that some characters, when an actor can take a character and really develop that character to be who they are. Like, so when you see that character come on stage, that actor has created that character to be a life-breathing person.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Their mannerism, the way they talk, the way they walk, the way they don't walk, the way they look. Everything has been brought to life by that actor.
So Darlene, for people who love theater, whether they're actors or directors or producers or playwrights or just patrons of the arts, the National Black Theater Festival has a whole gamut of workshops and they have vendors and all kinds of things there for the theater lover and the patrons. And this particular year,
mm-hmm.
the Readers Theater series will continue. However, yes. Garland has been there for every festival since 1989, mm-hmm. and this year he will not be there because yes. he passed in November of 2014.
Yes.
As Darlene will tell you, we had Act 1 and Act 2 in New York as a tribute to him. In February, and this year, as the finale, we're having Act 3 as a memorial to him at the National Black Theater Festival this year, and hoping to raise funds to support the Frank Silvera Writers Workshop and give this memorial for Garland Lee Thompson at the National Black Theater Festival this year. And there are all sorts of ways that you can help. And Darlene, as one of the executive producers, I guess, knows all about the ways that you can do that, right?
Yes, I do.
I'm doing the host and hostesses. I'm involved in sort of like the hospitality area of it. But Darlene is an administrator, so she can tell you more about the tribute that we've given to Darlene, because I'm sure that you can tell by the way we're talking that it's very exciting and it's very, you know, very, it's a thrilling business, and we're excited about it. We love it. And the more we talk about it, the more you're going to want to talk about it. So, you know, I just wanted to say that. So we
can.
Awesome. So Darlene, help us out. Let us know how we can.
Well, this is a benefit that's been in the planning process for 2 years. In 2013, many of the people who have attended the Frank Silvera Writers Workshop over the past years, and that has been 43 years that the workshop has been in operation, saw that Garland was a little frail, and they wanted to help him to raise funds to ease the process of keeping the workshop open on Saturdays and Monday evenings, because Monday in theater is black, and that's when the readings would be. Mm-hmm. Unfortunately, as Joan said, Garland did pass away, so we are raising funds by, you can go on, if you're on Facebook, you can go on my Facebook account. You can go to the Frank Silvera Writers Workshop account on Facebook. There's a PayPal, and you can contribute that way. If you'd like to be a sponsor, and we'd love to have sponsors, because what we're asking sponsors to do is to help us with some of the expenses that we have in order to make the tribute to Garland a success. We are offering for them to wave their banner, and we're offering to distribute their cards, if they're a business, distribute their cards throughout the festival, and we will give them VIP seating and a full page ad in the commemorative journal. So you can reach me at thework, thework at att.net, and I will respond back to you and give me your phone number. I'll be happy to call you and give you the details about sponsorship. We just love Garland so much. We are very, very excited that we have confirmed Lilias White, Tony Award winning actor Lilias White, will be the MC, along the mistress of ceremonies, along with Garland Lee Thompson Jr. At the event. So we're extremely excited about that too.
Wonderful. Thanks for telling us that.
Yes.
I think a lot of people will be interested in helping.
Yes.
Well, what we're saying is that the actual memorial will be on Thursday, August the 6th. From 3 until 7 p.m., and they will be having a special program memorial for Garland.
It's a benefit.
At the festival during this time, and it will be followed by a reception. So people who donate to help this event, or people who become sponsors, are given certain gratuities for this, including good seating and, of course, the enjoyment of the theater crowd, the reception afterwards, and being in the mix there, and as we pay tribute to Garland Lee Thompson Sr.
And it's going to be at the M.C. Benton Convention Center. That's where we'll be.
And that's in Winston-Salem, North Carolina.
Yes.
But we want to make sure that the people know that this Frank Silvera Writers Workshop actually takes place in New York, right?
In New York City. Mm-hmm. That's where it has been taking place. Now our new CEO of the Frank Silvera Writers Workshop is Garland Lee Thompson Jr., and we are waiting word to hear what his plans are sometime after the festival.
Okay. Now, you did say that a lot of people do attend the festival as spectators.
Oh, yes.
I'm also guessing that a lot of them are beginning or aspiring or maybe early career writers and playwrights. So my final question to you is, what kind of advice do you give them? Because I can't imagine you're choosing beginner's plays to be read, right?
Well, I'm going to tell you this. Beginner's plays are read. Seasoned playwrights are read. All types of anybody who wants to participate in the festival, you submit your work, and then it's up to that committee that is headed by Garland Lee Thompson Jr. this year. They will be the one submitting the plays. What we're asking you to do is come to the festival and enjoy yourself. You don't have to be young. You don't have to be old. You just have to be a person that wants to experience what the National Black Theater Festival is about. In the past, the National Black Theater Festival has recorded having over 60,000 people attend during the course of the week. Over
60,000?
60,000 attendees come to the festival every year during the course of a week. So you can imagine that why it takes 2 years to have another festival, yeah, because of the excitement and the work, and it's a lot of fun. You have a lot of celebrities, producers, any people who want to be in the arts, people who are actors in community theater. People who may aspire to be an actor or a producer or a writer, the whole theater community comes together to celebrate black theater, and this is going to be a momentous and historical National Black Theater this year because of the loss of Garland Lee Thompson.
Okay, thank you so much, both of you, for being on the show. Really appreciate that. We're talking with Darlene Gidney and also Joan Jay. I don't want to just say goodbye without having each of you just give us some parting words.
Well, I guess I would say thank you, Pat, for having us on the show. We really appreciate it. And I really did love Garland Lee Thompson Sr. And I would really like to see this memorial be a big success. So anybody that can donate or contribute, it would really be to the benefit and the growth of continued theater especially among African Americans. And I love the National Black Theater Festival. It is absolutely supercalifragilisticexpialidocious. If you haven't been there, do come. And if you can come to everything, definitely get yourself involved in the August the 6th memorial for Garland Lee Thompson Jr. You know, and I hope that you will make sure that they get Darlene's contact information so they can contact her. We have actors, local actors, and people who are involved in theater and spectators, patrons, right around in the Triangle area who are going to be there. We have playwrights who are going to be there. I can't tell you all of them because they haven't revealed it yet. But some of it I know, but it's going to be a blast. And one of the biggest things is this very special memorial that they're having for Garland Lee Thompson Jr. So donate, contribute, and come to the National Black Theater Festival. Thank you, Pat.
Well, I'd like to say that when I first met Garland Lee Thompson Sr., it was in 2003, and it was my first festival, and believe it or not, in the Marriott Hotel there, the Marquis, he was standing in his tuxedo, and it was just a marvelous thing to meet this gentleman, an icon, who I got to know very well. He was a very humble man. He never talked about the fact that he was in the first five episodes of
Star Trek.
He never talked about how he continually gave writers and actors an opportunity to launch their careers, like Angela Bassett, Charles Rock Dutton,
Samuel Jackson,
all of these people have touched the workshop and gone on. Denzel Washington, Pauletta Washington, I can go on and on. But when Garland did say to me that very first time that I had a conversation with him, he says, you know, tonight, it was on a Monday night, tonight is Larry's night. He said, but tomorrow night, it'll be all about the work. And that has been such a true mantra that he communicated to me, that it is all about the work. That's why my my email is thework, thework@att.net. And I just ask that you come and support us whichever way that you can to celebrate this theater icon. If you ever are in New York City and you want to take your children, or you want to go on a make it educational, you can go to the Schomburg Museum and go up to that section of the library. You'll have to go upstairs, and Garland has graciously preserved plays that were written by playwrights in the Schomburg. I think there's over 1,000 plays, photographs in the Schomburg that memorializes the workshop and has preserved the workshop in history. So, with all of that said, please come out to the National Black Theater Festival 2015. You will never regret it. You will be there in 2017, and you will always want to come to the festival because it is an exciting experience to be a part of. And Pat, I thank you so much. It was nice meeting you and seeing you and giving Joan and I an opportunity to talk about something that we truly love. And that's the Frank Silvera Writers Workshop and the National Black Theater Festival, because actually that's how Joan and I met, through the Frank Silvera Writers Workshop. And
I read in her play, the first one that she brought there in 2003.
Yes. Mm-hmm. Oh. So you meet a lot of people, and they're friends for life. It's just its own little family and community.
Nice. And actually, I have to say, even though I did thank Aduke Arenu for connecting me with the two of you, I have to thank Mark Lee, who lives here in Durham, I knew about the National Black Theater Festival, but I mean, I went only once and didn't really attend. Actually, my friend Maggie Brown was there years ago to accept posthumous award for her father, Oscar Brown Jr. Mm-hmm. And I just kind of drove from Durham to Winston-Salem to say hi, because Maggie's an old friend and Oscar grew up with my dad and all that. And while we're in the lobby, Sam Green Lee was there, and she introduced me to him. I almost fainted. Spooku sat by the door. I mean, come on, right? So
yes, Sam Green, yes.
Oh my God.
Yes, so, see Sam. Mm-hmm.
Right.
When you come, you're just surrounded by people in theater, people all kinds of old, young, and new.
But the cool thing is that they're just walking around like regular folks. They're not like profiling.
Well, they are regular folks, and that's what's so exciting about the festival, is that it gives everyone an opportunity to just exhale, and just then when they inhale, they're inhaling the aroma and their memories of why live theater is so exciting.
Wonderful. And with that, I bid you good night. Now, if you would like to be on TV Skywriter, I don't care where you live. I've interviewed people from as far away as England. So as long as you speak English and you're interesting, you're a writer, you're a musician, entrepreneur, whatever, write to me, durhamskywriter@gmail.com. The Durham Skywriter, that's what I call my community newspaper. It's online. It's an all-positive paper for Durham called the Durham Skywriter. TV Skywriter is what I do on Sundays. If you're in the Triangle, there's another edition. It's called TV Skywriter Local Edition, and I do that during the week. That's a 20-minute show, because that's during the day while people are supposedly you know, working, and I don't want to take them away from their work for too long. So just write to me, durhamskywriter@gmail.com. Love to have you on. And thank you, ladies, for being on the show.
Thank you for having me.
Good night, Darlene.
Good night, Joan. Good night, Pat.
Good night, John Boy. And with
and thank you, Garland Lee Thompson Jr. Senior.
Yes, thank you, Garland Lee Thompson Senior. Thank you.
Absolutely. Good evening, folks.
Good evening.